You're listening to the Futures Podcast with me, Luke Robert Mason. On this episode, I speak to the founder of Second Life, Philip Rosedale.
Inevitably, as we get more powerful AIs, we are then going to have our first example of a sort of digital native. The AI in the virtual world will truly live there and belong to that world in the way that we belong to Earth. And that fascinates me.
Philip shared his thoughts on what virtual worlds can teach us about being human, the relationship between Second Life users and their avatars, and the challenges of building the metaverse using Web 3.0 technologies. Virtual worlds and the people who inhabit them have long fascinated me. For many, becoming an avatar and exploring an environment of endless possibilities is extremely appealing. And you can understand why. Lived reality can quickly become banal compared to a space in which you can fashion a new identity, construct your own reality, and auto-generate new forms of meaningful existence. But today, with so much recent hype around the metaverse, the question of what sorts of worlds should we create is often ignored. With so much focus on the Web 3.0 technologies which will enable commerce in these spaces, few questions are being asked about what cultures, communities, and forms of creativity will emerge as a result of human beings interacting en masse as their avatars. Thankfully, Philip Rosedale has over 20 years of first-hand experience in observing the emergent properties that appear in the spaces between people when they are immersed in virtual worlds. Because long before Meta's promise of new horizons or a gold rush into Decentraland, there was Second Life, the platform that Philip founded in 2003. It is possibly the most enduring and successful experiment in what happens when people choose to create new societies through the use of digital spaces. My first experience of Second Life occurred in 2010 at the University of Sussex, where then PhD student and former Futures podcast guest Danny Ploger and his colleague Seda Ilter had organized an academic conference titled Reperforming the Post-Human. I was a 20-year-old undergraduate student at the University of Warwick at the time and had traveled to Sussex in anticipation of seeing a presentation by the artist Stellark. I was studying a performance art degree and had only recently been introduced by my supervisor, Dr. Tim White, to Stellark's unique experiments that range from robotic third arms to swallowable robots to ears surgically implanted into the artist's arm. About 6 years later, I would become Stellark's eyes as part of one of these artworks, but more about that when he joins us as a guest on the show. Back in Sussex, Stellark was attending the conference virtually, from Australia, by performing as his avatar. He gave us a tour through his Second Life Museum, a space that contained virtual renderings of some of his most iconic artworks, with walls adorned with virtual flesh, and all the while his iconic laugh echoed in the space, contrasted against a constant mechanical ping. It was a captivating experience. But what caught my attention the most was something that Stellark said during his presentation about the concept of a third life.
What we need is a third life. By that, I mean the inverse of what usually happens. In Second Life, a human prompts his or her avatar. Imagine if your avatar was imbued with an artificial intelligence, imbued with genetic algorithms, for example, or a neural net. Imagine if your avatar was somewhat autonomous, and imagine if your avatar wanted to perform in the real world, accessing your physical body. This would be a kind of third life. Second Life is for humans to exist as avatars. Third Life would be for avatars to exist as humans in real 3D space and time.
This idea of a third life fascinated me. Not only could you control your avatar, but one day your avatar could have some form of control over you. I asked Philip about this possibility on this episode, and I think you might be surprised to hear his answer. A couple of months after this conference, I had the chance to become an avatar myself by using Second Life. By chance, I'd met the University of Warwick mathematics professor, David Wood, also known by his avatar's name, Immaculate. He had built a Second Life island for the mathematics department at Warwick, and was kind enough to show me how to enter, interact, and most importantly, fly through the space. I spent the next few weeks learning how to customize my avatar and visiting various destinations inside of Second Life, including Martin Rothblatt's TerraSem Island, a popular space frequented by the transhumanist community. Eventually, in 2011, David allowed me to use the university's island to livestream my revival of Warwick's cyberculture conference, Virtual Futures, to Second Life attendees. Although I didn't continue to spend long periods of time in Second Life, during my time there, it was clear that this was a vibrant world full of a diverse range of people and possibilities. Like many of us during the pandemic lockdowns of 2020, I looked again to virtual spaces as an opportunity to connect with friends and colleagues. I even explored some of the new decentralized virtual worlds powered by cryptocurrency. However, none of these metaversal experiences had the same sort of feeling I got from Second Life in the early 2010s. Partly because deep down, nobody really cared about building something truly long-lasting or meaningful in these worlds. They were just there interacting because they felt they had to be there. They had hedged their bets on the digital currencies underlying these platforms, so they felt the need to interact simply to justify their investments. It's why Second Life offers us so much insight into how to design for digital interaction. And it was for that reason that I asked my friend and mentor Douglas Rushkoff to introduce Philip and I. It's rare that I ask Douglas to help me secure a podcast guest, but Philip is truly the first real anthropologist of virtual existence. The spaces that he helped design tell us so much about how we might choose to live, interact, and communicate in the future. And for the next generation of these experiences to be meaningful, it's important for us to learn from the recent history of virtual worlds. That's why I'm so excited to introduce Philip Rosedale to the Futures Podcast. Philip, it feels like we've entered this age of metaversal madness, and that's driven predominantly by the promises of Web 3.0. But in many ways, you've seen this all before. You know the real difficulty of building truly social virtual worlds. So when you just look at the lay of the land, how far do you think we still have to go?
We still have a ways to go, and there are still, I guess, what I would describe as like science questions, science problems, R&D problems that are pretty fundamental to getting to what I think many of us are imagining when we talk about metaverse, you know, and as you said, the promise of Web 3, which is for the most part, I think, an evolution of the kind of commerce and low friction transactions and governance and ownership, although that's important to the future, it actually isn't the kind of fundamental science problems that I think we still face in getting all this stuff working.
Well, you so wonderfully describe the virtual / metaverse experiences. You describe them as consisting of two elements: one, three-dimensionality, and two, the ability to make the internet a live experience. But what is it about the combination of those two elements that make these experiences the most important thing, I guess, meaningful?
It's a great way of putting it. I mean, talking about those two things, right? That the metaverse, I think of as being these two discrete things. One is the transition to 3D. The other one is this fact that the internet presently doesn't have people there. It's not a live experience. And so like getting to that live experience is the other piece. But like you say, when you talk about the combination of those two things, what you're really talking about is creating a space that the average person would be comfortable communicating with other people in. And as a subset of that, I think the most important one is something like what you and I are doing right now, where what about when two people don't know each other and they're sort of sitting down together for the first time? I think that problem is this one that is still a science project. We know that it works in real life, but in every other medium, in online technology mediated mediums, it's hard, you know, and we've just gone through what, 3 years or approaching 3 years of COVID, which actually demonstrated the problem for us. Not good news, but it kind of showed us in stark relief how difficult getting people in a room together online is.
Even the interaction now, to your point, I'm staring at my questions off to one side of the screen. I'm staring at your face just off to the other side of the screen. There's no ability to have eye contact. To do that, I have to look above the screen into the into the camera. So it does feel like this very odd experience that would almost be made easier if we were able to get rid of all of these things and port ourselves into something like an avatar.
You know, I think what you just said is such a good thing to pause on. You know, those of us like you that have had to have intimate, engaging moments with other people online have actually had to kind of train to do it. You just demonstrated that looking up at the camera. And I know, like you, I'm always amazed when I see somebody who really is nailing that. You know, there seems like there are almost people that are like expert level, right? Who just know how to like look right into the camera and then seemingly not need to look anywhere else. I think that demonstrates this fundamental problem, which is we're either willing to go to extraordinary lengths in terms of training or kind of suppressing disbelief, you know, to communicate with people online. Mm-hmm. But most people are still choosing to basically not do that, which is what I'm saying we've learned from COVID. You know, most people, I always say this funny thing. I always say, do you remember those few sad happy hours with your friends that you tried to use Zoom for in March of 2020 and April? Everybody laughs when I say that because they all do, right? We all were like, oh, okay, we'll just have drinks at the end of the day on Friday with our friends and we'll just use Zoom. Mm. And we tried that a couple of times. We all did. And we didn't keep doing it. And so I always say, like, why not? Why was it so bad? You know, why was that so hard? And I think that really kind of captures the problem. I think most people are either not willing to go into an online space, especially not one where they're strangers, or people like you and I in our work are forced to go through the process of accommodating the unusual nature of the online experience, such as doing a video recording like we're doing right now.
I was always fascinated during the lockdown experience. My flatmate had a much higher tolerance than I did. He used to do poker nights online on Zoom, and he'd start at 9 p.m. at night and he'd go till 3 in the morning. Now, there was alcohol involved, so that helped, but he would have six of his friends who, weirdly enough, only lived just down the road, and they would all come together and they would do this thing around social gaming, and it was the social gaming element that kept them engaged, and each would have their own music playing in their own room, their own lighting. I mean, people starting to get crazy. They would bring in a party style lighting to light up their backgrounds every time they got a good hand at poker or won the poker round. And it fascinated me that people can have that sort of tolerance, because coming out of these podcast interviews, there's often this moment of relief where I get to switch all of the lights off and I get to push the microphone away. And every single time I finish a podcast, I have to go for a walk to process what was said. And it's not until you do the editing process do you actually hear again what was actually being said, because you're so conscious of the fact that you are, I guess, creating the content in this moment in space and time. It's not just about being in the space for the sake of being in the space. But I guess that was the wonderful thing about Second Life and all these virtual worlds. It's the promise of being comfortable to just exist in virtual worlds. And that point of just allowing yourself to be, I mean, that's difficult to get right, isn't it?
Exactly. And, you know, the way that Second Life allowed you to be, to your point, was it basically said, we're going to give you these two very kind of easy things to do just when you're talking about just hanging around and communicating, which was one, you're going to actually talk with text, and then you're going to move an avatar around with your arrow keys, and you're going to be able to sit down next to somebody and you're going to be able to look at their avatar while typing to them. And it turns out that that is not a stressful experience. It doesn't have that weird, like what you and I are going through, where you're trying to balance between reading your notes and being present to the person. So you didn't have to do that with Second Life, because you could just look at that chat window and the screen, and you didn't need to keep managing your eye contact. And then, of course, you also couldn't see your own face looking back at you. Right now you're talking about, it's fun both of us describing our situations as practitioners of this. You know, I've got my Google window up over the self view of myself so that I can't see myself, right?
Well, I have my notes over me. So
yep. That's so funny. We're both doing that. And I had the same thing. I have your, you know, I have some thoughts here, you know, over my face. And that's because looking at your face is this weird downward spiral where you become less and less present as you consider whether your hair is good. And, are you looking? And then you become disturbed. God, I can see how I'm not looking at the camera. I should look at the camera. You know? Yeah. And Second Life, you didn't have to do that. You know, you don't have to do that. You talk. Some people talk about 30%, 40% of the time people talk. You type and then you move your avatar around. Now that's comfortable. And it actually really feels good in a group too, which is the other thing that's great. But not everybody, and in fact, only a minority of people are comfortable doing that all the time, you know, really kind of making it their life. And I think that tells us something too. You know, Second Life is a community for the last 20 years now of about 1 million people and not bigger. And the reason for that is that it gives you a second life, but it asks you to make trade-offs that are pretty serious. And again, in the time of COVID and to a lesser extent, virtual reality, we're all now kind of getting a chance to confront that same question, which is, are you willing to give up your body, your facial expressions, your nonverbal communication? Are you willing to give that up to get something that you really want or need or value? And for most people still, the answer is no. They're not willing to give up that nonverbal communication. And that, and of course, that's what you and I are in this liminal space where we're struggling with doing it well. But of course, we both know it's still hard.
What do you think it is that unites the average Second Life user? Is it a form of escapism from a problematic reality that they're having to deal with in the real world? Or is it the possibility space of being able to do pretty much anything that their imagination will allow them?
One of the things that's so wonderful about Second Life is that it's very diverse. So there isn't one answer that is a silver bullet here, but people are in Second Life, as I said, because they're willing to largely kind of give up their real life and their real bodies kind of in exchange for an avatar and the world of Second Life. And they're doing that for a variety of different reasons. So for one, for example, would be some type of a physical difference or disability that makes the use of the avatar really functional for them. So that's an example. Another one might be age. It's amazing. There are many people who are old enough that they're beginning to, you know, be challenged by their bodies in Second Life, but of course they're able to be young and kind of normalized, I guess, by becoming an avatar. So there's a lot of different people. Now, another one is just people that live in rural areas where their ability to engage in face-to-face communication is very limited, right? And so they need, they fill in the lost time with communicating as an avatar. So people come to Second Life from a lot of different needs, but the one thing they all have in common is a willingness to really commit to becoming an avatar. And it's not just Second Life, but many other companies and now metaverse companies are kind of taking on firsthand the same problem. And I think realizing what a hard problem it is, you know, if you're not getting rich in the metaverse, then you're left with what the real reality of it is, which is it's a space between people. You therefore need to be engaging with people and wanting to do so, wanting to create new friendships, wanting to create new connections, to be willing to go into these, you know, metaverses or these virtual worlds.
Well, there was something very revealing you just said there. Commit to becoming their avatar. Now, that assumes that their interaction with their avatar is an extension of themselves. They see some form of reflection in their avatar. It's not a third person in their life. It truly is a part of them. Right. How true do you think that is?
Well, not only am I sure that it's true, but there's been a big body of academic work in the last 10 years that has validated that, you know, that things like the Proteus effect, which was the name given to some studies done by, I think, first Nick Yee and then Jeremy Balanson at Stanford, where they studied the fact that when people take on an avatar, when they choose to live in Second Life, and they looked at some other worlds as well, there's evidence that what happens is they take back into the real world the experimentation that they do as an avatar. And therefore, surprisingly, or perhaps surprisingly for some, people tend to become more like their avatars. They use the avatar as a kind of tool to enable them to change in personal ways or physical ways that they weren't able to before. You know, that's one of the wild examples of what you get out of it. But again, you know, I, as the older, wiser me now, you know, I caution us to remember that it isn't yet something that your average person that you pulled off the streets of New York or something is going to be willing to do. But if you are willing to do it, yeah, the experience of becoming an avatar and then having that avatar be digital and more of a co-constructed thing. People misunderstand a lot of times. They have this idea that Second Life or that virtual worlds, and well, sometimes for virtual worlds, this is true, that Second Life is kind of like escapist in the sense that you can have it any way you want. You know, like your avatar can be anything you want and your life experience can be anything you want. That's completely not true because Second Life is populated with other people who are going to push back on you in exactly the same ways that other people do in the real world. So like your avatar's identity, the place that you live, the friends that you have, the neighborhoods that you hang out in are all part of an experience that is scrutinized by the other people that are there. So I don't know if I'm making that clear, but the experience of there being others around you and connected with you very much makes it not an escapist experience, but a challenge to be there, you know, in the same way that the real world is. You know, when you go to college, right, you are made, your reality is made by the many new friends and roommates and whatnot that you have as a new college student. And of course, your identity, as we all know, is fundamentally altered by that experience. I would say that the going into Second Life is a very similar thing. When people choose to go in there, they've got to go in there as a new avatar, and they are then shaped by the experiences with others. So it's a fascinating thing.
Well, you couldn't say the same about some Web 2.0 platforms, for example. Very few people are shaped by Twitter other than it makes them slightly more angry. And I guess that is captured in the language. Everything you were saying there, you have a social media profile, but you are your avatar. This idea of ownership, you know, something that is external from you versus something that is truly feels like that extension of you. And do you think that's going to be a challenge for some of the big tech Web 2 companies who are thinking about moving into the metaverse, that their user just doesn't have that fundamental change state in their mind of how this experience is going to be at the core extremely different?
Yeah, I mean, Second Life versus, say, Twitter versus something like Facebook groups or something like that, or Instagram. Yeah. These are all mediums, and more specifically, I would say they are spaces between people. There's a book about Second Life, but it's specifically about architecture in Second Life called Space Between People. And I always loved that expression, space between people. And if you think about Twitter as a space between people or Instagram as a space between people, exactly. It's the same thing. You know, the nature of the space mediates the nature of the communication. Now, fortunately, Second Life, well, strangely and happily, Second Life has, as a kind of a stark contrast to the last 10 years of social media, Second Life has been a good experience for people. And by good, I mean that they have grown by it. This is almost universally true. Again, academics have studied it. I have the emails. People that come into Second Life report that they became friendlier, that they became more open, that they went through life changes that were positive. Obviously, as we've all seen lately, going on Instagram or going on Twitter is not the same thing at all. But it's the nature of those spaces between people that influences the outcome. You know, if you add a lot of delay to communication, latency, right? If you make it more asynchronous, of course, human beings become very different because asynchronous communication is not something that we've ever known historically. You know, every moment of geological time, right, in which humans have been on this earth has been face-to-face communication. And then the last 10 or 20 years, we've suddenly had the opportunity to communicate without that. And so when you shift us to asynchronous, where you don't read the comment on the Twitter post until 5 minutes later or 5 hours later, people are not kind. They don't strike a balance. They don't regard themselves as having hurt someone who's standing right in front of them. So the difference in the medium and the design is critical. And then, as we can talk more about, then you can do things like advertising where you can actually intentionally cause harm, right? Like then there are, I think, ways that those spaces can work that are even worse than asynchronous, that are actually actively causing people to dislike each other for profit, which is what we've got with something like advertising on Facebook or YouTube.
Well, that's the wonderfully egalitarian promise of virtual worlds, as exampled by Second Life. They don't rely heavily on behavioral modification algorithms. And the big tech advertising model, it really just breaks in these virtual spaces. So do you feel that the virtual space, it offers a more ethical way to navigate social relationships online? And do you think the desire to apply some of these Web 2.0 design elements as new virtual worlds are appearing in the market will fundamentally be their downfall?
I certainly think, just as you said, that virtual worlds in general can offer a kind of neutral substrate that is, as much as possible, similar to real life, right? Or at least we can start with real life as an example of something where people are generally civil and good to each other. Like people face to face, as we all know, even in the world that we're in right now, almost 100% of the time, people that are face to face help each other out with things and don't hurt each other.
Yeah.
Of course, a small percentage of the time they hurt each other. And of course, we're all shocked and upset by that. And we should be. And, you know, we got to spend time thinking about how to not, you know, have wars. But the number of people, for example, in a given year as a fraction of the human population that die as a result of violent conflict is just an enormously small number, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that virtual worlds, therefore, can, by replicating, to start at least, the real world, can create a neutral environment where people are generally good to each other, just like in the real world. As you said, there's really just two companies, really, it's really just Facebook and Google that in the last, 10 years now, have gone astray from that kind of neutral substrate model. And I think the internet in many ways, well, the internet has been a lot of experiments, but there have been lots of neutral lifelike experiences like Second Life, like even Zoom, frankly. I mean, Zoom has problems, but it's not actively causing harm. But, you know, surveillance advertising, as demonstrated by primarily Facebook and Google, definitely does cause harm. And I guess the exciting human moment that we're in right now is, can we walk away from that? You know, given that it's such a big moneymaker for these, as you said, these Web 2 companies. Mm-hmm. But again, it's really just two. It's really Facebook and Google that comprise, they're the anchors of that ecosystem, right? Of the surveillance advertising ecosystem.
What I love about you, Philip, and the way in which you speak about these virtual spaces and these virtual worlds is the fact that value to you means something completely different. These virtual worlds, they teach us about what we value as human beings, and they amplify certain values over others. And yet Web 3.0 and the push towards the metaverse, it seems to put value purely in that financialization bubble.
Right.
It's purely about speculative economics as opposed to creating something together. So what do these worlds and what do the interactions within these worlds teach us about our values, I guess, in the real world?
Yeah, I mean, my first reflection on that is cryptocurrency and Web3, some of the worlds that we've seen people building, almost kind of starkly makes a point that we all, or at least a lot of us, already knew, which is that capitalism made like perfectly frictionless and anonymous, you know, like kind of, it's almost like capitalism taken to its insane science fiction extreme,
yeah,
is unsurprisingly, I think for most of us, can be a pretty destructive thing, you know, although it reduces friction, you know, allows any transaction to happen. In the limit of just allowing any transaction to happen, you get a bunch of really bad outcomes. One of the things that I've written about and blogged about and actually done some math, my background is physics, and I've done some simulation of this, is that if you start everybody off with an equal amount of money and then you allow them to engage in purely financial exchange transactions, buy and sell things from each other, you actually, even without having banks or evil governments or anything like that, you actually get all the money ending up in one person's pocket, like a poker game, quite rapidly. And Amazingly, there's a wonderful Scientific American article on this called Is Wealth Inequality Inevitable? From 2019. Surprisingly, I think for a lot of us, even myself, when I started modeling it, that is a kind of law of physics. It's a kind of a thermodynamic reality that if we allow capitalism, if we allow free markets to operate without anything else, if we basically create a virtual world that is just a free market, like you said, what happens is dramatic poverty and a small number of people having all the money. And it's kind of a mathematical law. It's not a property of people being mean or anything like that. Very well-intentioned people, you end up with one winner in the same way that you end up with one winner in a poker game, even when all the players are roughly equally skilled.
And that was the challenge you were dealing with largely with Second Life, wasn't it? This speculative question of whether if you give someone a sandbox virtual world, whether they'll become a creator or whether they'll just purely be a consumer.
Yeah.
And it feels like, and I still understand that Second Life has managed to strike that balance. There's still a velocity of exchange in Second Life. And part of the reason for that, and you've spoken and written so beautifully about this, is the fact that it was never based on speculative economics. The thing that really destroys these decentralized Web3 metaverse experiments is the fact that when someone buys their virtual space, it's a speculative asset. They're hoping that Steve Aoki or Snoop Dogg will move next door. And that was never the case with something like Second Life. Instead, it was about creating utility. If you bought your virtual land, you would build something on it, or you would create something, and you would add to the value of that land, not just sit on your empty island floating above it in the hope that that land would become more expensive due to the way in which the, I guess, the Linden dollar in the case of Second Life worked. I mean, the Linden dollar wasn't based on crypto, and because of that, it worked in a virtual world. That was the joy of it.
Yeah, I mean, the way you put it is good. I would say that, like, if you think about virtual land, and actually, I think Apple stock, you know, like the stock of a company, like, or Tesla stock, let's pick an even more funny example, right? Can be thought of as being based, you know, it's like two knob, you know, it's like in one direction of the knob, you have the actual utility of the space itself, right? Which, as you said, is if your virtual world is appealing and your friends come by, then there's value because there you are with your friends and more people come and you're having a fun time and you're all listening to music like in Second Life. And okay, so that land is worth something because tomorrow there'll be another party, right? So that's kind of the, like, just perfect utility side of it. And then there's the speculation side of it, right? So it's like, I'm thinking like every piece of virtual land or every public company stock is comprised of a portion, which is real utility. Like in Tesla's cases, it's they make cars and you can buy a car. And then there's a portion of it that is just speculating on the likely future and the greater fools. You know, like if there are people coming in that believe it's worth even more, why? They'll pay more for it. And why, if you hang on to your stock, it'll become worth more. And just as you said, you know, you can turn the knob all the way that way, which we've seen with some of the Web3 land sale stuff, virtual land, where you turn the knob all the way to speculation and you have this very ugly situation where everybody's just trying to flip property and scam each other and hope for the greater fool to buy their property from them, you know? But yeah, it could be done both ways. I mean, Second Life really stands out, as does, say, IBM or something historically, right? As an example of a case where the value of land in Second Life is largely driven by whether people show up there and what you've built. You know, the other point, as you said, separable from that is the value of a virtual currency, right? So as many people probably, it's kind of a complicated, interesting thing. But as you know, Bitcoin and Ethereum are cryptocurrencies, as are many of the other cryptocurrencies, which are, there's only a fixed number of units of the currency basically forever. And so what that causes is if there's any kind of increasing interest in using it, the price of the currency on the open market will go up. And as we've seen with Bitcoin and Ethereum, unfortunately, that means that they then cannot be used as a currency because when given the choice to spend them on milk or whatever, you know, a TV set or an experience, we will choose to instead hold on to them and not spend today with the hope that we'll be able to buy more tomorrow. And so, yeah, I mean, obviously this is kind of economics 101, but with Second Life, we regulated the amount of currency in circulation so that it would remain constant in value. And we were actually able to do that I think for reasons that make sense, but we were able to do that somewhat better than, say, real world governments do. And so we have gotten less static. You know, we did a fairer, I would say, job of printing money and distributing it than governments did. And we did a much fairer job than cryptocurrency, because cryptocurrency sort of intentionally doesn't print any more money. And that creates a failure case that any economist could have told you in 2008 before Bitcoin started.
Well, do you think there's some learnings there that need to be communicated more widely about why the Linden dollar was so incredibly successful in many ways?
Well, I mean, as we touched on earlier, even disregarding the dollar, the first thing about Second Life that's important is that it genuinely allowed people to use their own creative skills to build things of value. There's a lot of talk, generally people will use the acronym UGC, you know, for user-generated content. And they'll use it broadly to mean environments, platforms, spaces where people can make things of value. But that is a really big container. And within that UGC container, there's a lot of stupid stuff, you know, like, again, speculation. If you hand out, you know, 10 golden raffle tickets that attach to some unknown thing in the future, you're going to get a speculative exercise. And it's incorrect to say that the person who's hustling one of those tickets and selling it to somebody else is a creator or is part of the creative economy, as I hear said a lot lately. Second Life, on the other hand, by actually offering people building blocks and a toolkit that allowed them to make stuff, so completely devoid of any currency, actually allowed people to be creative and therefore to participate in an open market in which you could see who could make the more amazing hair for avatars, to cite a specific example. So it's really important that you creative sandbox, right? And then, as you said, it's important that you create a means by which people can engage in trade. And that's where the Linden dollar came in. We were just trying to do the thing that any community would do. I mean, I always give this thought experiment lately of, if you were stranded on a desert island with 5,000 other people and you were never going to leave, you know, like it was a big island or whatever with, you know, a good number of resources. If you were stranded there with a whole bunch of other people, you'd all sit down and have this conversation about how will we enable trade? Because somebody wants to be a podcasting luminary host like you, and somebody else wants to be a doctor, right? And so the question is, how do you allow people to do those different specialized things? And the way you do that is by creating money. But the problem is, you've got to create the money and use the money in a way that is fair for everybody. And so that's kind of that's the part we took on with the Linden dollar. We had to make a fair playing ground for people to be creative.
I mean, I guess the success is partly less to do with the code and more to do with this wonderful word, emergence, because it feels like emergence is the key to Second Life. These emergent properties, as you've so wonderfully spoken about in the past. And I just wondered, was emergence always part of the DNA from the beginning? Did you know that the way in which the success of these worlds would be defined would be through human scale, putting people in and allowing them to take, I guess, more than a decade to work out what the model is for existence in this space is?
I'm showing you my forearm right now, which has on it a tattoo. And the tattoo says cohesion, separation, alignment. And for those in the computer graphics industry, they'll smile when they see that, because the tattoo on my arm is the rules by which birds flock. And those rules create that beautiful emergent behavior that you see when you see a flock of birds, where they have these incredibly gorgeous patterns. And, you know, there's YouTube clips of these things called murmurations of starlings, where thousands of birds, when they get together, the patterns that emerge when those birds fly are just moving. I mean, they're spiritual, you know, when you see them, and they come from these very simple underlying rules. And so, yes, the idea of using simple underlying rules to create emergent behavior was more than anything what drew me to the very idea of virtual worlds as a kid. I was interested in physics. And then when I got into programming, I just had the good fortune of happening on to some examples, such as these bird rules, that were easy for a kid like me to try on the computer. And when I saw the emergent patterns and the complexity that resulted from these very simple rules, I became convinced that that was something that I wanted to spend my life working on, that it was so moving to see birds fly on a computer and realize that those simple rules underlie, you know, the beautiful things we see even in the real world.
Well, are there things that we're learning from these virtual worlds, these, I guess, mini experiments that are being done every single day from how people are interacting and the emergent properties that are arising from those interactions? Are there things that we can learn and then bring into the real world? If these are experiments in, I guess, post-vital living, if these are experiments in mini societies or alternate possibilities for the real world, could, I guess, governments and policymakers look at some of these islands and communities and go, you know what, maybe that's a way to run a country in the physical world?
You know, there was some groups in the early years of Second Life that were doing precisely what you're saying. They were aggressive and still are, but it started happening quite early on, where people would try different governance, you know, different forms of governance, different forms of communal living, different models for collective ownership of assets and things like that. In Second Life today, for example, there's a large group of people who love sailing, real world sailing, and they've built these very accurate sailboats that simulate sailing in the same way that you might use a flight simulator to simulate flying. And in doing that, they had to create these very large connected tranches of land that had waterways. And in doing that, they had to build and collectively own these kind of waterways and spaces and then agree as to how they would behave within them and things like that. So yeah, there's a lot of experiment going on in Second Life and in virtual worlds as well about how do we govern ourselves. And so I guess one of the hopeful things I would think about is that, yeah, as we go into these virtual worlds that have a little less risk in them, you know, like we can't actually die there. We can harm each other with words, but we can't harm each other physically. They do create a rich experimental ground for trying new forms of governance. And so I think we will find that. And I hope that Second Life in some small way says, hey, you don't have to go all the way to the crypto way of printing money. You can actually do something that's kind of like the way a government works, but everybody ends up being quite happy with it. And I think that's, you know, one example of something we did in Second Life.
Well, that's what I find so fascinating. The not about entering the virtual world, but the virtual world having affect on the real world. And one of your observations was how virtual worlds, they accelerate timescales. They accelerate everything we do. Right. And how true do you feel that has been? And in what way do you think those rules, they enable us to bend, break, or change reality?
As you say, I think speeding things up and just letting a lot of flowers bloom, a lot of experimental flowers bloom, is the fundamental thing that virtual worlds do. And then the other thing is they let us be more risky by taking the costs of risk down a little bit. They kind of open our hearts, as people often say these days, you know, that we're more receptive to each other because our inhibitions are taken down a little bit by the virtual world. And so it's kind of it's fundamentally a very rich experimental space. I do think we're going to continue to see things. I mean, for example, there was this book that was released, I think, on the 4th of July, I think The Network State, right? It's a really, really interesting book. It's controversial because he takes a very pointed, I think, philosophical perspective, which is unnecessary. It's not bad or good. It's just additive to the baseline statements he's making, which is that we now have the technical tools to rebuild the nation state in a variety of ways that is different than what we've historically done. You know, the nation state of history has been a geographic collective. You know, it's been all the people within a certain boundary in the real world. It's had a military, with a monopoly on violence, as people say. It has had typically a single national currency, right? It's had a certain requirements with respect to transparency and disclosure and identity. And the nation state of tomorrow, I think, will partly be a result of experiments in places like Second Life, where you've got all the building blocks to try creating a different kind of nation state and see, you know, how does a group of people want to form its own identity and create rules for themselves, right? You know, you have the anarchist, crypto anarchist perspective, which is there should be no rules and there is nothing but the individual. I think that's obviously nonsense, you know, but it's a worthy experiment to be jumping into, which we've been doing. But then there's just all these other variations. And I think in the end, what we get to is this idea of how do we come together in groups in a way that is best for us, right? Mm-hmm. And the real world has given us the country, and now we can try some other possibilities. And then I think, you know, I think what's likely is, and hopeful, is that we are going to be able to build, like the world is going to stay stable enough for us to build digital nation states of some kind. I was often quoted with Second Life as saying, I'm not building a game, I'm building a country.
Well, I mean, it does feel that way. I mean, America, in many ways, and this is coming from a Brit, America was the do-over country. It was the new frontier. It was supposed mm-hmm. to be the states were designed to be a multitude of small different experiments in governance. And as sort of federal governance has taken over the US and we realize there's nowhere to go after you've got all the way to California,
right.
It does feel like the next frontier is virtual space. And it's a place to play where the stakes, thankfully, are so much lower. You can't, I guess, colonize virtual space because there's nothing there other than algorithms. So
that's
it's
right.
a much safer space to engage with. And then if done well, it could have a massive impact on our belief in actually what's possible. And I think that's why voices like yours, Philip, are so important, because you have such a breadth of knowledge. And if done well, there's such an opportunity. But if done poorly, it could ruin the whole thing. And it does feel like, with all of the excitement around, you know, meta or metaverses, we could end up doing it very poorly, and we could all end up just seeing this thing as a, you know, conference room simulator.
Yeah.
And that's where the experiment ends. And that's my greatest fear for this.
Yeah. I mean, there's so much packed into that, what you just said. I mean, I think that first of all, as you said, we can create new land, if you will, in virtual spaces, and we can then go into that land in some ways similar to our, say, moving west in the United States. But the thing that is hopeful, though, is that we can do that without a colonizer's mindset, where we view the experience as depriving those who were there before us from their rights and their resources, and instead truly look at the collective experience as being co-creation and moving into empty, you know, moving into genuinely sort of tabula rasa. But it is possible to do all that with a colonizer's mindset, which is terrible. And as we talked about before, fighting over a cryptocurrency that's going up in value is exactly what creates that kind of negative sum game outlook, right? Where we just want to, we feel that we have to survive only by stealing from others, right? But the opportunity with virtual worlds is to see it exactly not that way, and to realize that we can co-create a larger space that we can then all share. But we have to figure out, again, touching back on this kind of why people go to Second Life, which is for each other, we have to figure out how to share that space together. And, you know, that's where, right, like you say, that's where the promise and peril comes in, you know? If, for example, we're sharing it by surveilling each other and then exploiting each other through advertisements, you know, that's a great example of a very, very bad dystopian outcome. But yeah, I think there's an opportunity to do it right. And I think Second Life is at least a, you know, one example of being able to do it right.
Yeah, it was always fascinating to me that when you entered into Second Life, you didn't necessarily have a home or a property or a starting place. And yet some of the promises of, again, I'm trying to avoid mentioning the company, but it's some of the live demos we've seen, say, in the last year, you have your homestead. That's where you select your clothes, you spend most of your time, and you interact with others.
Yeah.
And it's not about that, really. Nope. It doesn't feel like it should be about that. It should be about this co-creative experience. If it's truly going to work, it has to be done from the bottom up. Again, the egalitarian thing about Second Life was, it was, look, here's the tools to build, and you guys work it out. Allow for the emergent properties just to be. But when you do that, it feels like folk are very quick to emulate or simulate what they see in the real life. And I've always wondered whether that was because you needed a way in which to make people feel comfortable in these spaces, or it was a design of the physics, or if it was a failure of imagination. Because a lot of these spaces are trying to emulate real worlds. You know, there's gravity simulations and there's physics there, and you're a bipedal body with two arms and a head. We never go truly weird. If we wanted to build another world, you know, what about a world that would melt? Why do all these worlds have to feel so incredibly familiar? Is that an engineering issue? Is that the fact that the physics models that create these virtual worlds, you have to start somewhere and it helps that feeling of being there? Or do we just need to let the imagination run wild and see what we can truly create outside of anything we've experienced in lived reality?
That's great. I used to get asked a lot, and I think in my rasher younger years, I'd sometimes be mean and say, well, that's a dumb question. But people would ask me, what surprised you about Second Life? And I'm kind of like, oh, for heaven's sakes, look at what it is. I mean, it was pretty much designed for everything to be surprising, right? But what did surprise me is just what you said. With a tool set which would enable people to create almost anything, people, statistically speaking, surprisingly to me at the outset, created things that were from the real world. So the example that I always would think of would be, because we both know these two, we all as human beings know these two artifacts. Would you rather in a virtual world drive around in a Lamborghini or a land speeder from Star Wars? And I always thought the land speeder would be the choice because it can kind of fly, right? And, you know, it would be spectacularly imaginative and wonderful to build, you know, strange spaceships or starships or whatever. And yet, the thing people built first was the Lamborghini. And the reason for that, though, what I came to understand, I think, is that we subconsciously, and we cannot keep ourselves from valuing most those things which we have seen most before. So cultural artifacts like Lamborghinis or Rolexes or whatever are things that we have come to value in the real world. And so our first, I think, instinct is to rebuild those things in the virtual world. I used to say that Second Life is kind of, again, statistically, Second Life is very, very large and diverse, but statistically, Second Life is the average of all our dreams, what it must look like. You know, I used to say this, what it will look like is the average of all our dreams. And the average of all our dreams is Malibu. It's Los Angeles, California.
Well, people need weirder dreams.
Yes, yeah, exactly. Well, but you know what we did see, though, is that people start with Malibu and then get weirder and weirder after that, which I think is wonderful. So I think inevitably we build first what we knew before in these virtual worlds. And of course, this is true for even things like radio as a medium or something. You know, we started with the things that the structures and the rituals and the things we knew before. And then we eventually go beyond that. And again, like you said, it's a time machine. Hopefully we can just be more urgent. We can get people to get out there and, you know, get stranger and more imaginative a bit earlier than they might in the real world.
Yeah, weird alternative anatomies where you can just be a slime mold or sushi or something entirely other. There was one idea that I wanted to run by you, which I first heard from an artist friend of mine and a friend of the show, which is this idea of not just Second Life, but Third Life, which is, I guess, the melding of AI with avatar-based lives. And the artist was Stelark, the performance artist Stelark, who did a lot of artistic experiments within platforms like Second Life. And he would always bemoan the idea that when you log off, you no longer exist in that reality. So in his mind, a third life would be where avatars, these extensions of you, they would know enough about you from your behavior inside of those platforms or elsewhere, that when you sign out, your avatar can then take over. It can continue to navigate the virtual world, continue to live your life and make decisions, or perhaps even make friends on your behalf. So by the time you sign back in, it would have made a friend that you in the real world or you in Second Life would actually want to spend time with. The question would be whether, you know, it was two AIs becoming friends or a human and an AI becoming friends. Do you think perhaps that's the future of this, where we port an element of our identity and allow it to live independently of us to do experiments on our behalf inside of these worlds. And, you know, we sign out and then we sign back in and we, you know, we find it in some form of virtual strip club and we're like, well, what are you doing? And they go, well, I'm part of you. So you tell me what I'm doing here.
Well, first of all, let me thank you and say we go now into one of my very favorite kind of philosophical excursions, right? Which is the melding of artificial intelligence with virtual worlds. And that's one that lately has taken up a lot of my time. I've had a real interest alongside simulation. I've had a real interest in kind of the mind. And then, of course, as AI has continued to grow as expected, you know, it has come to a point where AI is powerful enough now to be somewhat like us and soon to be beyond us in a number of ways that we're already seeing. Mm-hmm. And so this topic is just absolutely near and dear to me. And there's so many things to say about it. As you said, one imagined experiment is what you just said, which is what if an AI that inhabits your avatar in the world kind of learns from you and then continues on without you in the world? I think that's very likely to happen. I think there are good and bad possible outcomes of that. I think the ethics of like keeping people alive after their death so that they can be visited with in virtual worlds is very fraught. I don't think that's an easy one to even start into. I think that somebody pretending to, an AI pretending to be you is going to homogenize your behavior in one of the ways that has been dangerous, you know, like social media is making us all into beautiful people living beautiful lives, right? So that's changing what we really are in the medium, say of Instagram, into something that's not just not true, but more importantly, is just boring. You know, like we're all becoming the same. We're becoming the same beautiful person on Instagram. So I think there's risk to that. But ranging afield, like you're saying about AI, one of the things that has interested me the most historically has been that the avatar was always something different than the rules of the world. So what I mean is Second Life has physics, so you can roll a ball down a hill in Second Life and it really will roll down the hill and you can't not have it roll down the hill. You know, the laws of physics are unbreakable in Second Life in the same way that they are in the real world. But the laws of physics stop at the skin of the avatar. The avatar, and this is true both, by the way, this is true in virtual worlds, like something like, you know, Facebook's Horizons or whatever. The virtual world with avatars, with people wearing VR headsets makes this all the more true. The world is typically running some sort of laws of physics of its own and has things that live wholly within the world. Like the ball rolling down the hill in Second Life is truly part of Second Life, right? Like that ball is on its own. It is evolving forward according to the rules of Second Life, which is this shared rule set. Everybody has to abide by the fact that the ball is going to roll down the hill. But the avatar is this really weird transitory thing where it is being animated, puppeteered, if you will, by a human who is outside the simulation and is not subject to the laws of physics. And so, of course, there are good aspects to this. You can't kill someone, you know, by killing their avatar, right? Thank goodness. But there's a certain lack of reality in that breaking of rules, right? And so this is one of the things that I've been fascinated by because, as just as you say, inevitably, as we get more powerful AIs, we are then going to have our first example of a sort of digital native. The AI in the virtual world will truly live there and belong to that world in the way that we belong to Earth. And that fascinates me, that we're going to see things which are alive and intentional and are fully contained within these simulations, living things that are there. And I think that the collision, right, between us and them, if you will, is going to be fascinating and uncertain. You know, how do we engage with artificial life forms that not just live in virtual worlds, but are part of their reality in a way that we aren't?
Well, because they're part of their reality, I've always found them more authentic. So we've got this rise of the virtual influencer like little Michaela, and she's a product of the platform of Instagram, and she's a virtual avatar that is existing a life that is purely fictional and purely virtual. And the reason I find her more authentic is because she is a product of that medium. Human Instagram influencers, they are manipulating their face through filters. And not only that, they're manipulating the reality around them. They're putting rainbows in the sky. There's pink filters on reality. You know, they're taking something right that is real and morphing it into something completely other. So if anything, I would trust a virtual entity perhaps more because it is a product of that virtual world, that virtual reality.
Exactly. I mean, well put. I mean, I think that there'll be an authenticity, if you will, you know, whether it's good or bad or whatever, let's see. But there'll be a sort of an authenticity to the virtual beings that truly live in these worlds that we won't have. You know, I think there's this grave danger of AI being harmful to us because we as human beings have this hubris that is undeserved. And we're going to discover that real quickly in the next few years here, you know, to think, for example, that I can never be manipulated by an AI, right? I mean, come on, we know those days are over. And so I also worry, you know, kind of more broadly than just virtual worlds, I worry, can humans interact with AIs that are so much smarter than them that they can easily manipulate the humans, right? It'd be like, you know, us and our pets, right? You know, our animal pets. I mean, probably the animals might harbor the illusion that they can outsmart us, but it isn't true. To us, pets are very easy to manipulate. Humans are going to be easy to manipulate for AIs. So where's that going to go?
Having heard everything you've just said there, I do have to ask, flying, like, was that just a practical way to get around, or was there something more significant to the idea of being able to get off the ground? Because, I mean, as a kid, I remember seeing Peter Pan. It was like one of the first theater things I ever saw. And obviously it's on wires, but Peter Pan flies. And I remember the first time I used Second Life, which I think was around, it must have been 2010, 2011. The minute I could fly, I was like, well, this is it. This is what I've been waiting for since I've been 5 years old. So what was that piece? Was it purely a transportation system? It just made things easier for the engineers? Or was there something more philosophical and hopeful going on there?
If you go and look at Second Life today, you'll notice that when you fly, your avatar has a particular animation that it also does. Those who know Second Life well can see it in their heads right now, which is, it's a kind of a Trinity from the Matrix sort of animation, you know, in the mid kick, you know, where the arms are outstretched and the body is kind of floating like a god or something. That was very intentional. Right. We looked at things like, I don't know if you remember how Superman flew. He kind of had that like one arm forward and one arm at his chest. We actually spent so much time on flying because it was such a spiritual experience. And I used to, when demonstrations were going badly in the early days of Second Life, which happened a lot, you know, because bad bandwidth or, you know, slow computers or whatever. And I was presenting Second Life to, say, a journalist or something who was writing about it. If things were kind of falling apart and not working so well and they weren't understanding the world, I remember I would reach over the journalist's shoulder and I would hit the F key, which is fly. And, you know, their avatar would rise up off the ground into that animation. And then I'd press the arrow key forward, or I'd tell the journalist to, and they'd hear the wind in their ears, which is another thing I personally worked on quite a bit, the actual physics of the wind in your ears. And everybody would suck in their breath. They'd be like, oh, you know, that's cool. So yeah, that idea of being able to freely move as if you were underwater or as if you were a bird, it's really powerful. I mean, I wouldn't say I completely understand it, but it was very intentional. We wanted it to feel great.
Yeah.
By the way, we didn't want you to teleport everywhere. I could talk about that for hours too, but the idea of jumping instantaneously, however, from one point to another is actually undesirable for a variety of reasons. It surprises the people, you know, it's unfair to the people at whose position you're arriving, right? Because you're kind of surprising them. And we've discovered this really with the VR headsets even more. It's very upsetting to you. If I basically teleport you, even a few meters, by the way, from one place to another, as some VR games do, it breaks, your brain has a kind of a map. Literally, you have these neurons that are quite literally like spaced as a grid in your brain, and moving along a line through that neurological space is vital to our sense of presence, our sense of being in a space. And so teleporting breaks that illusion. It rattles you out of the flow-like sense of moving continuously through a space. So it's a really interesting thing. So that was another reason why we wanted to make flying work well, because we wanted flying and walking to be the preferred means by which you got around, and teleporting to be less frequent.
That's so interesting. That it, I never thought about that. But yeah, the teleportation piece, it does break the place illusion. It jars you out of the, I guess, the existence in that time and space at that moment in that space. One thing you famously spoke about was the idea of digitizing everything, the goal to digitize the world. Does that still remain a North Star for you, whether with Second Life or otherwise? And are there some things you came to realize that it's just impossible to digitize? It's something that is just so tricky or fuzzy that we'd never be able to place that into virtual worlds? Or as an engineer, as a physicist, is it hard for you to not see reality as code now?
So I think that's great. I would say that the younger me who was talking to people in 2006 about Second Life, I did say that we should digitize everything, that was the goal. I would say now, after 20 years of thinking about it, I don't agree with that anymore. I think that, one of the reasons people say they want to digitize everything is to reduce friction. That's the famous word. And I think somebody, maybe me or somebody needs to write a book called like Friction to basically talk about how, you know, that the utopian idea of making everything, the idea of making everything frictionless is this utopian nonsense that is not in fact the end game we strive for. You know, that for example, we have only a limited ability to take in information. And so that means you do want friction around some things. You know, some stuff you want to come to you more slowly, some stuff more quickly. So I think the goal that I had about digitizing everything, I think that was a youthful, well-intentioned, but, you know, kind of a utopian perspective. I think that particularly, for example, being forced to share the world's natural resources with each other is a kind of game, if you will, that is very important and inherent. It is a very important part of the human experience. And so if you seek to digitize everything so that none of us have any limits on what we're doing, I don't think that's a world that we want anyhow. You know, like our experience as human beings is to share the world with each other and to do so in a way that is mutually satisfying. And I think that a lot of the digitize everything, even the spirit in which I said it 20 years ago, was kind of, hey, shouldn't we all be able to get away from each other and not have any responsibilities or something like that? Mm-hmm. And I think that's not true. I think now I've come to a much greater reverence for the limits of the world. And so I kind of think the thing to do now with technology is to say, what are the right kinds of friction? You know, how do we build virtual worlds that are hard in the right ways and easy in other ways? And then I think with the benefit of, say, 20 years, I can try to do that in the future better than I did in, you know, 2006.
And I think that's so important for people to hear, because when folk today, they talk about digitizing everything, really the only reason to do that is to stick it on the blockchain. So every single object and thing that you own, whether in lived reality or otherwise, has some sort of numerical code attached to it. And going back around to this more simplistic way of dealing with these virtual spaces, I mean, that's what I love about what you did with High Fidelity in 2013. You realize that sometimes less is actually more. And High Fidelity is this incredible spatial audio based experience. And what did you find that was so unique about sound, other than visuals or the need for virtual avatars, that also gave the human brain that feeling of being there, also gave a, I guess to use the name of the company, a high fidelity experience for an individual?
Yeah, I mean, I think sound and our ability to stand in a circle around a fire, you know, the campfire is this kind of fundamental element that we've all rediscovered in the age of VR, right? That standing in a circle facing each other as a group and then communicating is this fundamental human experience. And the thing that makes that work is spatial audio, because spatial audio lets you just talk in the same effortless way that you always have done before. And, you know, as you know, technically what happens is we move the sounds of the other people's voices around in space, which is this hard math problem that we've done very, very well at High Fidelity. But we basically present the sound of another person's voice over there at that place where they're standing perfectly. And what that enables is for everybody to just talk comfortably and not have to mute themselves and unmute themselves and do all that stuff, because on Zoom or on a telephone call, on a conference call, if two people talk at the same time, they both have to stop, wait, and start again because you don't understand either one of them. And that's because when you hear sound coming from the same point in space of two people, your brain can't understand it. And so, yeah, the simple thing we took on, which turns out to be a lot of math and a lot of code, but not, as you said, as an experience, it's very simple, is just to make the sound work correctly. And so I think spatial audio is a requirement for future virtual worlds in which we can collaborate. I think as we touched on at the beginning, with regard to the minority of people that are willing to go into Second Life, for example, we're still not there yet because even the audio by itself is not quite sufficient to, say, mediate interactions between strangers. You still need some nonverbal information, perhaps some eye contact and gaze information, things like that. And I think that that's probably going to get solved, but we still don't quite know the science that we're going to have to figure out to make it magically happen. But yeah, spatial audio allows people to come together and solves this problem of just being able to talk at the same time, which is so vital to human beings.
Well, the wonderful thing is there is an entire next generation of young individuals who might be able to solve some of these problems, and they might be better equipped to solve some of these problems because of tools like Roblox and Minecraft. Are you excited for this next generation of future builders, having seen some of the projects that they're doing in these spaces?
I really am. I mean, I watched my kids, for example, build in Minecraft and was very inspired by it. You know, my kids were able to, as early teenagers, you know, people stop using systems like Minecraft, Roblox, and Fortnite at about 14, at about the point where they become mature, you know, they begin to become adults. But in the time before that, when they're younger than that, yeah, the way that kids use these buildable environments, these plastic environments to kind of play together and communicate is very inspiring. And I think we are going to see qualitatively different systems that are built by the kids that are becoming developers today, because their way of manipulating the world around them is just different and new. And we're going to really see that play out. I do think, though, as a side note, that it's still important to recognize that late teenagers today, as a particular cohort, actually are very demanding of authenticity in communication. They don't use avatars for live communication. They don't use filters for live communication, by the way. They force FaceTime or Discord audio live, no modifications, on each other. And I think they're actually doing that as a reaction to all the nonsense and all the Instagramming and all the made up lives that we've been, you know, kind of doing over the last decade. So I would say that cautiously, the kids are not the ones that are going to use avatars in virtual worlds yet, but they're going to build the next generation of worlds to their own needs. I don't think they're going to flood into, you know, the Web3 virtual worlds. Those are not what they're going to want. But I think we may see them build something beyond that.
The ability for this stuff to go towards a smartphone,
yeah,
for you, that's the key, not virtual reality headsets. I was fascinated to learn that.
Yeah. You know, I think that famously, you know, Facebook missed mobile, and they managed to kind of get back on the horse by buying a bunch of companies and stuff. But for Second Life, the transition to mobile was much more hard. We never made it because I think the window of the mobile device, historically, especially as you said, in the age before the vast amount of compute and things like facial recognition that we have on these devices now, in between time, it really reduced the liveness and the sense of being that you kind of have with virtual worlds in VR headsets or on large 2D screens. The smartphone is this different target that I think none of us know how to build for yet. And again, I'm sure that the younger people that are coming of age now as developers, they're going to build new things for us. And like, if you want to change the world in a positive way with virtual reality or virtual worlds, you're building for the smartphone, because you need to remember the number of people worldwide who have got fancy computers with GPUs is not anywhere near the global population. It's 10 or 15% of it or something at best. And so if you're going to really change the world, you need to pick up that smartphone and figure out how you're going to do community and belonging and togetherness and emergence and communication through it. And I don't think anybody quite knows that yet.
So Philip, this is the Futures Podcast, so I have to ask you to just for a second look into the future. And if I was to ask you what virtual experience you hope someone might soon build, or what form of immersion you hope you might get to experience, what might that actually be in the future?
Going to school. So, you know, Ready Player One is this film that everybody talked about a lot, and the book and the film differ in a very significant way. The book gives you the critical piece of backstory that legitimizes the whole virtual world that you see in the film. And that backstory is school. The idea in the book is that the real world has collapsed, particularly the United States, as described in the book, in a way that the kids have to go to school with VR headsets. And as a result, they build connections. They build deep and lasting connections with other kids with whom they went to school, that they can then go on adventures with. And the film is basically, sadly, skips that whole backstory and presents a kind of a dystopian vision of a, you know, kind of a horrifically financialized and, you know, game-like world, very, very shallow game-like world. But what lies behind that is this idea of going to school. And I would say that the way in which, whether on smartphone or devices or whatever, the way in which the world can be changed, and I think is likely to be changed next in the future, is that we really will be able to go to school in virtual spaces. And I think once we can do that, that is both, one, a positive thing, if we can provide it with equal access to all. The experience of studying something together with other people in a virtual reality, in a virtual world, is going to be completely revolutionary. And, you know, Second Life still has many, many colleges and schools experimenting in different ways with it, because I think we all sense that something is going to pop here at some point. And VR is going to get good enough, virtual worlds, there's going to be breakthroughs, there's going to be smartphone breakthroughs that make us able to like go to school with other people in a class. And so I personally, I still point to that. And I think that even more practically in the near term, that's likely to be something really big that we're going to see.
Well, Philip, it feels like you've certainly schooled me on virtual worlds. And on that absolutely fascinating note, I just want to thank you for being a guest on the Futures Podcast.
Thank you so much for having me. This was fun.
Thank you to Philip for revealing the impact virtual worlds can have on society. You can find out more by visiting rosedales.com/Philip. If you like what you've heard, then you can subscribe for our latest episode or follow us on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram @FuturesPodcast. More episodes, transcripts, and show notes can be found at futurespodcast.net. Thank you for listening to the Futures Podcast.